Hello and welcome to this first tutorial on Dave. The purpose of this first tutorial is to get you started as quickly as possible. So open up the graphical user interface and repeat after me. Let's go! A model in Dave is composed of small building blocks called nodes. And a combination of nodes is called a scene. So let's start with our first node. Our first node will be an axis. Well, we can create a node by right-clicking here on the viewport, for example, and then we select New Axis. And then a window will pop up asking us for the name of our node. For now, we'll just stick with the default name, which is Axis, and press OK. Three things. First of all, we have a visual for our axis system, for our node. We have the node here in our nodes list with the name. And thirdly, in our node properties editor, we get all the properties of this node. The coordinate system is simple. It's a right-handed coordinate system. So X, Y and Z. And the Z-axis points upwards. First, let's take a minute to get used to the viewer. When you hold the left mouse button, you can rotate your view. When you hold the left mouse button together with control, you can rotate it in 2D. Or if you hold the Alt button, you can rotate it in or out of the screen, so to say. With the middle mouse button, or pressing down your scroll wheel, you can pan the zoom. Scrolling the wheel, you can zoom in or out. And if you've zoomed out a lot, then holding your mouse pointer still on something and pressing F will focus the view on that element. And if you've messed up your rotations, which I happen to do a lot, you can always go back to a horizontal camera by selecting View and going to Level Camera. Make horizontal again. Or simply press Alt plus L. So, an axis system has 6 degrees of freedom, X, Y and Z translations, and 3 rotations. Now, the translations are applied first, and the rotations are applied secondly. To show that, I will first create a second axis system, else we cannot see if it actually moved or not. So I will right-click and say New Axis, and we get the same screen as before, and this time I will call my axis Axis 2. Oh, by the way, node names need to be unique. So if I try to use the same name as something that I already have, it says, hey, pick a unique name, please. So I'll just call this one Axis 2. And I will not give it a parent for now. So there's now 2 axis systems, Axis 1 and Axis 2. You only see one, but that's because they are at the same location. So I've now selected Axis 2, and I will move it in the X direction. And now you can clearly see the 2 different axis systems. And level. You can see that if I change the location here in the node properties editor, it will instantly move. And by rotating it about the Z axis, the Z axis, you can also clearly see that the translation is applied before the rotation. So take some time to play around with the 3D view and to mess around with these coordinates just to get some feeling. Now, another thing that we can do with axes is put them on top of each other. So in this case, we have 2 axis systems, Axis 1 and Axis 2. and both of them are defined in the global access system. But we can also create an access on top of another access. So to do that, I will select my first access. I'll right click on it, I say new access, and I will call it access on top of access, and I will select my original access system as parent. So now if I click OK, you can see here that in the node view, my new access system is actually located on top of the first one. And that means that if I give it an offset and a rotation, rotation about the y-axis for 15 degrees. So now if I actually move this first access system, just rotate a little bit, then you will see that you can see that the second access system now moves with the first one. Well, we can do that again. So on top of this second access system, we can create a third one. So access number 3, located on top of the second access system, or the access on top of access system. Not confusing at all. And I will give this again an offset or a translation of 2 and a rotation of rotation on the y of minus 15. So you see what we are doing here. We're creating a nice circle. I will get rid of this access system, access 2. Just right click and delete. There we go. So on the third one, of course, I can indefinitely add more access systems. Access 4 based on access 3. Give it a translation and give it a rotation. If I made a mistake, so if I want to change the parent of an access system after I've created it, I can just drag and drop it in this list to put it under a different parent. So now if I change the orientation of the second one, let's rotate it a bit in the other direction, you'll see that this access system here is affected, but this one is not, because it's not connected to this access system. Sometimes when you try to drag things around here, you get this cannot drop sign. That's a bug in the windowing system. What helps is to drag it out of the view and then drag it back in, and then it actually does work. Okay, now I promise you to tell something about degrees of freedom. And degrees of freedom are actually the fixed property here of all the axes. I will illustrate that in a new model. So I'll go file new, clean it up a little bit, and I will start with an axis. I call this, I'll just keep calling them axes because it's easy. And now on this axis I will introduce a point of interest. And a point of interest is just a location. In this case, a location on the axis. So I'll say OK. And I'll put it at x equals 5. Zoom out a bit so that we can see it. I'll put it at 10. So, there we go. And now I will add a 4 to the point of interest. So I right click on the point of interest, I say new 4. I'll just keep calling it 4 based on point of interest. And this 4, I will give it a negative 5. So 5 kilonewtons downward. Okay, so now we have the access system. On the access system we have a point of interest, and on that point of interest we have a force. Now, if we look at the derived properties, that is this window here. Now, drag it out. It's going to be smaller. There we go. If we select an element, in this case the point of interest, then in the derived properties window, it will show you all the things that it figured out about that node. So in this case, Dave determined what the global position of this point of interest is, being 10, 0, 0, so 10 in X, 0 in Y, and 0 in Z, which happens to be the local position as well. And it also figured out what the global applied force and moment are on this point of interest. And in this case, it's 0, 0, minus 5, 0, 0, 0. In other words, 0 moment and 5 kilonewtons downward force. The same goes for this axis system. So if you click on the axis system, you'll see that the axis system also receives a force, because the force is located on the point of interest, which is located on the axis system. So the axis system gets an applied force of minus 5 kilonewtons, but it also gets a applied moment of 50, which is the distance between the axis system origin and the point of interest, times the force. So it gives us a positive moment of 50 kilonewton meters about the y-axis. And now, because all the degrees of freedom of the axis system are fixed, the axis system is able to transfer all the applied load to its parent. And in this case, the parent of the axis system is the static environment. So that results in a connection force between the axis system and its parent of minus 5 and 50, which is the same as the applied force. In this case, if I would run, or if I would hit the solve statics button, which would normally solve statics, it will do absolutely nothing, because the model has 0 degrees of freedom. So there's not much to do. That changes if I remove one of these degrees of freedom. So we see that this axis system receives a moment about the y-axis, the local y-axis. So what if I would unfix that one? So I uncheck this box. And if I do that, you immediately see here in the derived properties that the applied force stays the same, but the connection force, or the connection moment I should say, changes from 50 to 0. And in the meantime, the equilibrium error goes up from 0 to 50. So if I uncheck this box, the axis system is affected by a change in the connection force and the equilibrium error. Now, since we have an equilibrium error, that means that the model is not in equilibrium. And that means that if we hit the solve statics button, it will try to find the equilibrium position. Well, not all the way. Keep it here. So let's do that. See if it works. Solve statics. It's a miracle. It worked. So what did it do? Select the axis again to update the properties here. What it did is it changed the value that was here. The value here was 0. But because it's not fixed, the solver is allowed to change it in order to get an as low as possible equilibrium error. And now if you look at the number, it looks like something. But if we enlarge the window a little bit, we can see that the equilibrium error is actually 10 to the minus 7. So, we've solved equilibrium for the first time. I could do the same with all the other degrees of freedom. So I could untick the X and Y translation, and I can untick the rotation about the Z-axis and the X-axis. I can solve again. But it will not do anything, because it was already in static equilibrium. So it's now still in static equilibrium. What I can also do is check the Z translation box. And if I do that, then we have a system that will just fall down because it's not fixed to the world anymore, but we are putting a constant external global force on it. So if I now hit solve, you will see this nice dialog box saying, hey, I'm doing what you told me to do. The maximum error is still 5.0 kilonewtons. And it's not really going anywhere. I mean, it's working very hard, but it's not going to get there. So I can just hit the button saying terminate solver. And then it will stop. And I can either, let me just click this button that says undo solve. And it will bring it back to the situation that we had. So I will fix this one again. I'm free to play around with the rotations, so I can specify any initial condition that we have. And if I click solve, it will just rotate or adjust the degrees of freedom until it finds a nice equilibrium position. And as you see, before we had 0, 90 and 0, and now we have something different. That is because the equilibrium position in this case is not unique. I mean, I can rotate this whole system about the vertical axis, and every position that I choose is an equilibrium position. So it's good to realize that the solver will find an equilibrium position, but the solution that it finds is not necessarily unique. Play around a bit, have fun. You can do the same with stacked axes. And you can also add multiple points of interest, multiple forces. And just play around a bit and see what happens. Okay, so up till now it has been very nice and theoretical and simple. But since this is our first tutorial, I would like to show you what we're actually going to be able to do. And for that, we have a couple of example models, which we can easily open by file and then import. And this will show you a list with all kinds of pre-made assets. So we have the turtle. If you double click it, it will open. It's a semi-submersible vessel. We have the husky, which is a small duck. We have the octopus, which is an 8-legged semi-submersible. And for now we'll just use the cheetah with the 4.4-prong block. So I'll double click this one and say import. And then we have a nice model to play around with. The first thing I want to show about this model is that the buoyancy, it's actual shape-driven buoyancy. So what you can see here over the hull, there's a mesh. And that mesh is used to calculate the center of buoyancy, and that is then used to calculate, for example, your stability curve. So let's do that. Let's go to marine, stability curve. And then we need to type the name of the vessel, cheetah in this case. And we need to give the displacement, which is used to calculate your heating arm. And in this case we actually know the displacement, because it's, well, one of the properties, or one of the derived properties of the displacement, or of the buoyancy node. So we just need to copy that value here in kilonewtons. So there we go. Need to specify the range, number of steps, and I will untick this one, the delete temporary nodes. And I do that such that we can see afterwards what the stability curve macro did. There we go. And there we have it. So this is our restoring arm curve for the cheetah. It also gives us the GM value. You see that it's nicely nonlinear. It also gives us the trim resulting from, well, the imposed heel. and it has inserted a few notes in our scene to actually enforce this healing angle on the vessel. And it's nice because then we can actually use those notes to see what the calculation did. So this is the final stage, the 60 degrees heel, the solved statics. And then we can see that it actually solves the correct position, for example, of the crane block. And now this node here, this is the node that actually, I can close this one. This is the node that actually imposed the heel on the vessel. So if I change this one to, let's say, 30 and hit solve again, then we get the situation that was actually reported as the situation for 30 degrees heel. So you can see that it correctly includes the partially submerged deck in this case. So what else is cool? Well, of course the crane is cool. It's a heavy lifting vessel. So let's see if we can do something with that. But first let's remove this heel. I'll just set it to 3. There we go. So now it's again free to find its heel. So can we play with the crane? Yes, we can. Let's slew it to the other side. So if I click on the crane boom, it will first select the visual for the crane boom. Well, that's only for visualization. But what I can do is I can click it again. And if I click again on an already selected visual or already selected element or node, I should say, it will select the parent of that element instead. So in this case instead of the crane boom visual, it will select the crane boom itself. Now the crane boom itself we can use to change the crane radius. So I can change this number here. But if you paid attention during the first part, you will observe that it's not fixed. So I can change it. But then if I solve statics, it will just readjust to its equilibrium position. What I can do, or what I should do in this model to actually change the crane radius, is change the length of this wire, the suspension wire. I, for example, set that to 30 meters instead of 40, and I solve again. It will simply boom up. The same goes for slewing. I can select the slewing node of the crane, just double click on crane slew. And then I can rotate the crane. Again, you will see that the block doesn't move with the crane. That's because the block itself is again composed of a couple of rigid bodies in this case. And the upper block is not fixed to anything, especially not to the crane boom, or at least not in terms of degrees of freedom, which means that it will only change position due to the force in the crane wires. So I can rotate the crane boom, but the block will only follow when I solve statics. So there we go. The block also has, well, as you see, the block is modeled from several nodes, which means that the block is able to rotate. Or rotate and hinge about all these different points, and it will do so when I add a force to one of the prongs or when I suspend an object from it. For now I will just add a force because we know how to do that. So new force attached to prong 1, okay. Downwards force of 2000 tons should do it. Now it's a huge force, but we don't see it. And it is actually there, it's just very, very small. So you can see the tip coming out here. What I can do is I can go to the view menu and I can say hide visuals, or actually uncheck the show visuals one, and then we can actually see that it is here. Well, it's also obviously here. Another thing that I can do is I can go to the same view menu and just increase the size of the forces. And I can either click this one or use the shortcut, which is Alt plus the square bracket. So I'll just do that. So now we can actually see the force. Level again, Alt L. So now if I solve, we see that this block gets a not so nice angle, and also the vessel gets a not so nice healing angle. We don't like this healing angle, so we typically would like to reballast the vessel. At this moment, ballasting is not yet included. It will be soon, but what we can do is use the goalseek function. It's in the optimization menu, goalseek. And what I want to do, I want to set the healing angle of the vessel to zero. So the vessel is the node, so that is theta. And the property is the rotation about the global x axis, so that is gx, grx, global rotation about the x axis. I want to set that to zero, and I want to do that by changing the COG y, so the y position of the center of gravity of the theta. Go. Solving, and it is done. So it took 3 iterations, or it's not that many, and it has updated the COG position of the vessel. So let's look at that. Yeah, it's now something weird, or something that I didn't come up with. And if we look at the equilibrium position, so soft statics again, and select the theta, then we can see that the global rotation about the x-axis is indeed almost zero. So we can goalseek. How cool is that? Another cool thing that we can do is we can use Blender to make cool looking visuals. Of course, this is already quite okay, especially if I turn on the water plane. And well, there we go. But we can always make it better, and in this case we will do so by using Blender. I'll go to Blender and say render current view, and that will open Blender, and there we have our vessel, including our weird loading condition on our crane block. And we can use Blender to produce nice looking visuals or animations. So I can go to the EV shaded view, or I can go to the cycles render. I'm going to the GPU if you have one. I do. And we can play with the lights and the camera and make animations, put in all kind of reflections and that kind of stuff, just to make it look fancy. Okay, that's all I wanted to show in this first tutorial. We now know what nodes are and how to create geometry using axis, point of interest and force nodes. We have seen how degrees of freedom are specified and how this affects the forces in the system and just the equilibrium positions. And we've also seen that equilibrium positions are not necessarily unique and may not even exist. We saw that with our system falling down indefinitely. And finally, I took some of your time to show off and to motivate you for the next tutorial. I hope you like it. If you have any questions, let me know by commenting on this video. And I hope to see you again next time.